Yes,
Hi.
hello, now I share. Okay.
You have 25 minutes and then 5 minutes
Yes.
for questions.
Can everybody, can you hear me? And do you see also the pointer, the cursor moving around?
Yes, we can see it.
Yes, perfect. Okay. So you will give me 5 minutes interruption.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Thank you.
Please
Hello,
go ahead.
everyone.
Yes.
I am Lorenzo Gavassino, third year PhD student. I would like to thank the organizer for giving me the opportunity of making this presentation. And the topic of my talk is hydrodynamic stability. In general, I will consider an arbitrary fluid in which you want to include any possible effect you want. You can include magnetic fields, superfluidity, superconductivity. I will not be specific in the particular kind of fluid you want. And this presentation is going to be something philosophical, more in general, about how do we approach the stability problem and what we should do and what I believe we should do. So, first of all, let's start with what is a hydrodynamic theory? Okay, what is a hydrodynamic theory? So basically, when you prescribe hydrodynamic theory, you need to make three choices. It's a game of three moves. First thing is you choose some fields, and these fields should somehow track the information that you want to track. So if you have these fields across all the space-time, you somehow assume that you have all the knowledge about what you are interested in. Then once you have chosen this field, in the case of the perfect fluid, one typically chooses a fluid velocity, the temperature and the chemical potential, but one can take something else. And then the second thing that one needs to choose is some constitutive relations. What are the constitutive relations? Basically, if you have some quantity that you are interested in, and this quantity is not just your fields, since you assume that your fields track all the information that you want, you need to be able to write these other quantities in terms of the fields that you have chosen. For example, if you have a stress energy tensor and you want to know some energy density, particle density, and so on, you need to write it in terms of the field. The third step consists of prescribing the dynamics of the fluid. How does the fluid evolve in time? During this talk, I will consider these three things as three distinct logical steps in making a theory, although of course they are often interconnected because some field equations are conservation laws, so they depend on the constitutive relations. But just from the point of view of the perspective, why we consider these as three distinct elements. So let's assume we have made our theory, we have prescribed these three things, and then we ask whether this hydrodynamic theory makes sense. So in order
Okay, Lorenzo,
okay, so
you can
go ahead.
Resume.
Yes, okay.
Yes.
So I was saying, typically you need to test two properties. First is causality, and Professor Disconzi already talked about it a lot. And causality intuitively is the idea that I cannot use your fluid to send messages faster than light. I cannot put a kick in the fluid and hope that this will help me communicate with somebody that is outside the future light. And the second property is the stability. And intuitively, then we will be more specific, but intuitively stability is just the idea that glasses of water do not explode spontaneously in your hands while you are holding them. If you don't bother them, they shouldn't explode. This is the intuitive idea behind stability. And in my talk, I will focus on this property, on the stability property. And I will not talk much about causality. So first of all, we need to understand the foundation of this property. Where does it come from? So the idea is that stability in a nutshell, there is a state called the thermodynamic equilibrium. In the case of a glass, you can imagine it as something like this, towards which isolated dissipative system tend as the time passes. So the idea is that if you prepare your fluid in a generic configuration, you wait for a while, and there will be, at one point, a thermal equilibrium, diffusive equilibrium. After a while, you will get a configuration that is somehow like this. The quantity of these states will be computed using a statistical mechanics. So it is important to realize that what we are saying is that there are some principles outside hydrodynamics that impose some rules on our hydrodynamic theory. So the principle of stability is a principle of compatibility between hydrodynamics and, if you want, thermodynamics, because this idea comes from the second law and from thermodynamics. And systems initially prepared in this equilibrium state shouldn't depart spontaneously from it. So intuitively, the idea is that if you prepare the system like this, it moves here. But if you prepare the system like this, it shouldn't move here, if we neglect the spontaneous fluctuations and we work within a regime in which we can neglect them. In practice, how do you check this property? Well, the idea, I give you an example, but the methodology is quite general. Imagine that your fluid can be described using just a real scalar field. And you know that maybe it's a peculiar fluid, but you know, everybody loves scalar. So the idea is you find the equilibrium state, and this equilibrium state is given by statistical mechanics. And you introduce a perturbation. You linearize the field equations around the perturbation. In this example, you can imagine the Klein-Gordon equation, but it can be whatever, of course. The perturbation sounds kind of, I don't know, I introduce a little kick, a sound wave. So I perturb the system and I see what happens. I solve the field equations, and typically I get that the perturbation will be proportional to an exponent that can decrease and that can increase or decrease. And I require that the perturbation does not grow. So if I do like this, I obtain some conditions on the field equations. And this is basically what? This is basically it. This is how you test hydrodynamic stability in general. Let me just make a couple of comments. So the equilibrium state that we are talking about is the thermodynamic equilibrium, not a generic state, not an accretion disk or the Bjorken flow, because we are testing the compatibility with thermodynamics. And then another important comment is that what I have presented is the stability of the dynamics of your field. So it's the stability of the field equation. So we can say that it is a non-shell criterion, because if you don't specify the field equations, basically you cannot compute. So this is the starting point. Now, the question that I want to ask is this stability criterion enough? Of course, I want to argue that it is not. And I would like to explain why it is not with a simple example. So imagine that I decide to describe a peculiar fluid that is just a perfect fluid with finite chemical potential, as we know it. But then I decide, for some mysterious reason, that I want his specific heat to be negative. I make this decision without knowing anything else. I just decide that I want to make a fluid like this. So I build a theory just taking the fields of the perfect fluid. In this case, sigma is the entropy per particle, and P is the pressure. I chose these fields because it is convenient. Then I write down the constitutive relations for the stress energy tensor. This is the enthalpy per particle. Its differential is given by standard thermodynamics. And I include this peculiar thing. Specific heat is negative, my choice. And I also include also the field equations are the usual conservation laws, as we know. Now then I ask, is this theory stable? I make the calculations precisely as we did with the scalar field. So I say, first of all, let's find the equilibrium states. The equilibrium state, let's take the simplest thermodynamic equilibrium possible. So hydrostatic equilibrium in 1+1 dimension, just fluid at rest and uniform configurations. Then I introduce a small perturbation, so a small velocity, a kick, and maybe some perturbations to the quantities. I linearize the field equations. I do all the calculations. I do not report them. But basically, in the end, what I discover is that there is a kind of mode that has indeed an exponential in it. And I don't want it to grow. The exponential contains this thing. If I impose that the perturbations must not grow, I immediately obtain that I need to impose the speed of sound squared larger or equal, larger than zero, actually. Then if I also want to ensure causality, I need to impose also the speed of sound smaller or equal than zero. And we know from a theory, actually from a theorem from Benfica et al, it also guarantees that I am stable in every reference. So in principle, there is nothing else. And now I make an observation. I notice that if I take the enthalpy per particle and I take the second derivative with respect to the entropy, I get something that contains the specific heat. If instead I make the second derivative to the pressure, I obtain something that contains the sound speed squared. These are diagonal elements of the Hessian of the enthalpy with respect to different variables. And so it's easy to understand that they are completely independent partial derivatives, so their signs are not related. You can also make a check just with a polynomial dependence. You will see that in general, the signs of these two things are independent. So I am completely free to impose the specific heat negative, but at the same time, the speed of sound squared positive, and my model is hydrodynamically stable. So if I do like this, then I'm super happy. Wow, I have discovered that that specific heats can be negative without any problem. Of course, this is not the end of the story, because you can check, you can make an experiment. There is no way to generalize this model, for example, to Israel and Stewart. Paper of Hitchcock-Lindblom, in which they compute the stability conditions for Israel and Stewart, you will find in equation 95 that necessarily for Israel and Stewart to be stable, you need to have specific heat positive. But then you can say, okay, it's not important. We can just assume that Israel and Stewart is not the proper theory. Let's do something simpler. We go to Newtonian physics, and then you discover another problem. You discover that anti-diffuses. Well, the reason is quite simple. When you have the diffusion equation for the temperature, the coefficient in front of it is this thing. K must be positive because of the second law. And so if you have this thing that is negative, you have the inverse heat equation. And this is of course a problem because we all know that the inverse heat equation is not even, doesn't behave well and is not even physical. So you think about it, and then you discover that there is a simple problem here. The problem is that imposing CP smaller than zero is completely incompatible with statistical mechanics. The reason is that if you take the isothermal isobaric ensemble, there is a relation that connects the specific heat to the fluctuations of the entropy. And this guarantees that the specific heat at constant pressure needs to be positive. One may say that, okay, but maybe we may just think that for this fluid, the isothermal isobaric ensemble does not exist. But actually, this is not realistic because in the end, the isothermal isobaric ensemble is the natural ensemble of the fluid elements when you are in thermodynamic equilibrium. So clearly, this thing, the fact that this relation tells you that you have a problem with this theory. And that this theory clearly is in contradiction with statistical mechanics. So what is the conclusion? The conclusion is that the criterion of hydrodynamic stability that I have presented is important, but is not enough to guarantee that your theory is compatible with statistical mechanics. You need to guarantee something more. You need to make a stronger check for the stability of your theory. Now there, in the rest of the talk, I will try to present how to extend the stability criterion in order to incorporate also all the other criteria that come from statistical mechanics. First of all, a brief summary of typical inequalities that you get from statistical mechanics. The typical inequalities you get are positive specific heats, positive compressibilities, then the ratio between CP and CV is the adiabatic index is always greater than one. You get many of them directly from the books of thermodynamics and statistical mechanics. And essentially all of them come from fluctuations identities. So for example, this coefficient is related to this fluctuation and so it must be necessarily positive. So what do all these relations have in common? Let's go back to the beginning when I told you what one does when they prescribe, when they build a hydrodynamic theory. I told you that you need to, it's a game of three steps. And you immediately notice that all these conditions enter here. They are properties of the constitutive relations. They are something that you impose on the quantities that you are going to measure. They are not properties of the field equations. Of course, in general, constitutive relations and field equations will be connected. It is important to keep in mind that these quantities exist even before we assign a dynamics for the system. They are really conditions for the physicality of the stress energy tensor and everything else, even before we say how the system evolves. This difference is important because if you only take care of the hydrodynamic stability I told you, which means if you only take care of how the system evolves once you have prescribed the field equations, but you don't take care of all these criteria connected with the constitutive relations, you might end up in a situation like this. You might end up in a situation in which you take your fluid, and as long as you move on shell means along the solutions of the field equations you have chosen, everything works. So as long as you just solve your equations as you have created them, you will not notice any problem. But as soon as you introduce any additional effect, as in the case of negative heat, negative specific heat, you might get troubles. And this is, for example, the case of the specific heat. In the case in which you want to add some little additional details, so for example, diffusion of heat, then your theory is completely destroyed. You get something that doesn't make any sense. Or, but this is not only if you include additional details. For example, we have seen that the theory didn't make any sense from the point of view of the fluctuations, because you check and the fluctuations tell you the specific heat needs to be positive. Furthermore, you might also consider the idea that you take the system, you couple, you make interact with something else, with a heat bath. And it might happen that this interaction with the heat path breaks the on-shell evolution and the fluid becomes totally crazy. And even the numerical error can create problems. So you don't want a situation like this. What you want is this. You want your on-shell fluid to be the biggest shark in the sea. You want to be able to feed your theory, including details, fluctuations, and heat baths, so including stuff. You want that these will just improve your description, include details. You don't want them to destroy completely your theory. Because if they destroy completely your theory, it's a clear signal that something is wrong. So now, in the final part of the talk, I will just explain how one can guarantee that this and not this is the case. And the method is actually very simple. The method is ensuring hydrodynamic stability. And it works like this. You take your fluid, and you know that there are two possible descriptions, a thermodynamical description and a hydrodynamical description. The thermodynamic description is based on your extensive quantities, the total quantities, so total internal energy, total entropy, total number of particles. But in general, you include all the constants of motion. So for example, if you have an equilibrium that rotates, you may include also the angular momentum and that you want. This is one possible description. The other description is the hydrodynamic description that uses the fields. Now, to check thermodynamic stability, you just need to make three steps. First step, you use the constitutive relations to write all your thermodynamic quantities in terms of the fields. So in practice, you just follow a strategy that has already been summarized by Professor Beccatini. The idea is that all these quantities, you can interpret it as them as fluxes of some currents. At the end, the total entropy is the flux of the entropy current, also the number of particles. Here, for the energy, you need to take a killing vector field of interest. So you write all your thermodynamic quantities in terms of the fields using the constitutive relations. And here it's where the constitutive relations matter. Then in the second step, you do analogously to what you were doing in the other stability criterion. You take the thermodynamic equilibrium as a reference configuration and you take your curve configuration as your other and you define the variation of every quantity simply as the difference between the perturbed and the unperturbed quantity. You may work exactly, so there is no expansion for the time being, but then in practice, of course, you will make some expansion. For the time being, you can do everything exactly, philosophically. And then the only thing that you need to do is apply to impose the maximum entropy principle. You just require that any perturbation decreases your entropy whenever your constants of motion are conserved, because you know that the entropy is maximized among all the possible states compatible with constants of motion of the system. So you just impose this, and then you make all the calculations using your fields. You write everything in terms of the fields, and then you get your conditions of stability. Now, let me tell you just some interesting consequences of using this approach, some fun facts. The first fact, thermodynamic stability implies hydrodynamic Lyapunov stability as long as the field equations obey the second law. And this is actually quite intuitive. If your equilibrium is the maximum entropy state and you perturb it, you go down with the entropy. Then the second law forces the entropy to go up. Then this is just And this is just the Lyapunov stability criterion. You know that the perturbation cannot grow spontaneously. The other interesting thing is that you never use explicitly the field equations in these calculations, because you always work at a given time. You just need to make your integral given one hypersurface. This simplifies the calculation, but also tells you that this stability criterion guarantees stability for every field equations that you may choose which obey the second law. Then it is also interesting to note that all the statistical mechanical inequalities, like the positivity of the specific heat, follow from the maximum entropy principle. So they are all directly accounted for. You get them for free. Furthermore, you also guarantee stability to fluctuations, because it is well known that probability of being due to spontaneous fluctuations to be in a state that is different from the equilibrium state depends on the difference in entropy. If you guarantee that this is positive, that this is negative, you guarantee that the equilibrium state is different. And then you have also others that I will not go through because I'm running out of time. I rather would like to present you a couple of examples. So the first example is perfect fluids. You make all the calculations, and what you get is that your perturbation to the entropy can be written, expanded to the second order, as the flux of this current. And you see immediately that there are both the speed of sound and the specific heat. And indeed, you get all the stability conditions, including speed of sound positive and positive specific heat. And Hitchcock and Lindblom have shown that everything else follows from these conditions. So for perfect fluids, it works. Then you try to Israel Stewart. You do the same calculations, you get this current. And the interesting thing is that this current is precisely the current that Hitchcock and Lindblom used to prove the stability of Israel and Stewart. So automatically you get that all the famous conditions that have been given by Hitchcock and Lindblom are the same. And then this also clarifies something about Eckhart theory. So the problems with Eckhart theory, because if you want to work in a first order theory, basically, you want to expand your entropy to the second order, and typically we have a Hessian like this. If you want to work only in a first order theory, then you set C equal to zero, but then it's immediate to see that if you kill this, then your entropy becomes a saddle point, and you immediately get the famous instability for the Eckhart theory that we all know. So in conclusion, to sum up, basically thermodynamics rules once again, in the sense that we have thermodynamic criterion that tells us a lot about the stability properties of a system. And I would like to conclude also telling you that tomorrow on the archive will be a new paper in which we prove that close to equilibrium, thermodynamic stability, as I have presented it, also implies causality. And this is actually not a surprise, because you see that you get also this condition of causality in this case of the perfect fluid when you compute the stability. So with this, I would close, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Lorenzo, for this interesting talk. I apologize for the interruption. Okay, now for question, Marcello.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Lorenzo. Very interesting talk. Very nice. Thank you. I have a question about, so your criteria goes through look at the entropy, right? And yes. My question is, strictly speaking, correct me if I'm wrong, but strictly speaking, I think, you know, we know exactly what entropy is for the equilibrium system, so it's okay for the ideal fluid. or via the Boltzmann's equations when you're out of equilibrium. And we make definitions like in Israel Stewart, we define an out of equilibrium entropy, but I think that's there's a certain degree of arbitrariness in that. I mean, because the only actual honest definition of entropy out of equilibrium is the one given by the Boltzmann's equations. So in that case, so how do you know which entropy to pick if you're looking at a system out of equilibrium?
I understand the criticism. So give me just
it's not a criticism, it's a question.
Sorry?
It's not a criticism, it's a question.
No. Yes, no, yes, of course. The idea is that you can... it may be true that in general, if you start from a completely arbitrary situation, you might say that there is some degree of arbitrariness. But in many cases, the idea is that you actually take your fields as somehow characterizing some sort of ensemble that you have in mind, and you want to associate these and you can associate an entropy just basically counting the number of states that are in this ensemble. So in the simplest idea that you may have in mind, you just take, okay, I take my perturbations, the fields are these, I count all those, intuitively, then in practice can be a problem, but I count all those microstates such that all the little quantum states, such that in the macroscopic, at the macroscopic scale, I will see this description. I will see this value of the fields that I have selected. So typically, if you start already from a formalism, like for example the formalism of Martini, in which you really have also the non-equilibrium density matrix, and then you have everything, then basically you have your entropy directly computed from there. Then, of course, in practice, in many situations, it's not directly given. Israel and Stewart were guessing it. Somehow they were just expanding, and then you need to take what you take. So you can also take it just as a practical way to be sure. You just say, I take the entropy, and I want to construct it in such a way that everything works. I agree that in practice, sometimes it can be hard. And I think that this is actually an interesting direction of exploration. Of course, what I'm saying, all this method works whenever you have an entropy that obeys the second law strictly. Within the BDNK formalism, the entropy that is expanded to the first order doesn't obey strictly the second law, so all the discussion does not apply. But of course, there is this recent paper from Noronha, Speranza, and Spalinski, in which they say that BDNK can also be taken as a limit of a second order theory, and in that case, you have the entropy. Many times you get the entropy, in the case of Israel Stewart, for example, you get the entropy directly from the relaxation time, and the relaxation time is computed from the Kubo formulas. So sometimes you need to know how the system behaves. But yes, sometimes it can be not trivial.
Thank you, that clarifies, thank you.
Yes.
Okay, next question, George.
Hi, Lorenzo. Thank you for this talk.
Hello.
So if you go back to the fun facts.
Yes.
So the fun facts, I don't see anything that is actually requires or is related to relativity. So where does relativity enter in the fun facts there?
I think it doesn't.
Yeah, so that's why I'm interested, because you mentioned afterwards that you have a nice connection between this type of thermodynamical stability and causality.
Oh, absolutely.
So I want to see where it comes from.
You're absolutely right. This is really interesting. So the point is that if you have the entropy current in relativity, you say that the entropy is given by the flux of the entropy current. And then you expand this entropy current to the second order. And typically you get that the second order correction to the entropy current has the form of the flux of a second order current. And then you want to impose that this second order current gives you a negative contribution in every reference frame. this in the end reduces to a condition that tells you that this current needs to be time-like. And you can verify that if this current is time-like, automatically this imposes that perturbations cannot propagate outside the light cone. So this is now hand wavy, you will see the paper, but it's related to the fact that when you need to impose thermodynamic stability, you need to impose it in every reference frame. So for every hypersurface, and this automatically gives you also the causality. It's something that indeed at the very deep level, still even us are not completely able to understand just to till the end. We give an interpretation in terms of information theory, but it's still just the beginning. For the time being, it's just
Lorenzo, so if that's the case, it could be that this is coming from a dominant energy condition. Actually, it looks like it. If it has to do with the fact that this E nu is time-like, it could mm-hmm. be related to the energy mm-hmm. condition, the dominant energy condition. That would be very nice to see.
This is interesting. This can be proved from statistical mechanics, just using that idea of the ensemble and that you count the microstate of the ensemble. You can show that it is the current of information. So it tells it's something peculiar, but you know the entropy is connected with the information. You make some calculations and you show that this in you tells you how the information about your microstate of the system propagates. And if you guarantee that it is time-like, somehow you guarantee that you cannot infer information about your microstate from a perturbation that is outside your light cone.
Yeah, it sounds like the dominant energy condition to me. Okay, very good, thanks.
But tomorrow you can give a look at the paper, and also if you can also write to me a comment, it would be very interesting. Still, we have not submitted it because also comments would be for sure welcome.
Okay, we run out of time. Marcello, if you have a very quick comment, then we conclude.
Yeah, it's a very quick question, Lorenzo. I'm going to look at the paper tomorrow, but when you talk about the causality, is like a full nonlinear causality or it's
It's not full. In practice, it's just the linear causality. But you never linearize the equations. But the idea is that the causality is the causality of a perturbation, is the propagation of a perturbation from the equilibrium state. Because basically you compute the information about the microstates and it's not the full nonlinear causality. In fact, Israel and Stewart is thermodynamically stable. It's not fully nonlinear, nonlinearly causal. So, yes.
Okay, let's thank Lorenzo again. This concludes this session. We can stop.